I did entitle this Top 9 Vegetable Garden Insects. I should have said Vegetable Garden Pests, but if you've listened to a webinar by me before, I am a huge advocate of beneficial insects, and I've talked about them extensively, but I wanted to take it from the perspective of growing vegetables organically. And how is this accomplished by a backyard gardener like yourself? The first thing I always say is if you do not scout your garden, you will never be organic. Because when it comes to organic methods, they're not quite as effective as some of our chemical treatments. And so we really need to be up on managing smaller populations rather than huge devastating populations where you would actually have to pull out some of those more harmful chemicals. So another thing is you have to promise yourself that you are going to scout your garden regularly and you are going to look for these insect pests, but you're also going to look for their damage. You're going to look for their poop, the frass that they leave behind. And these kinds of things are going to let you know what you have. Then you go ahead and identify it. But one of the things that I consistently say is sometimes you got to have a plan on how you're going to attack these garden insects from the moment you put the seed in the ground. You got to know what you're looking for. And so these 9 vegetable garden insects are the ones that I detest the most and have the most issues with. So I thought I would share how I would attack these vegetable garden insects. So I will talk about biopesticides today. I'll talk about beneficial insects. I'll talk about things like exclusion, where I'm asking you to create physical barriers. I will talk about, rotating crops and, starting gardening in a different way to address when these insects are going to come out. There has been a little bit of research on trap crops, which means it's a crop that I plant that will actually attract my garden pest away from the plant I'm trying to grow. Companion planting, still not a ton of really great research, but there's still some concepts out there that can be helpful for some gardeners. So I'm going to go ahead and start with the first one. You guys saw it, tomato hornworm. I absolutely love it when I find these guys. They are, oh, I'm sorry. I don't love it when I find these guys because I actually do love it when I find these guys. But this one caterpillar, which can be up to 5 inches long, like a really large caterpillar, can cause a lot of hate in tomato growers because it is, even though it's a very large caterpillar, it's very difficult to find it at times. The way that I can tell that I have tomato hornworm is if I have bare stems. All of a sudden you come out and the whole tip of a branch has been eaten up, or you see poop left behind. You really need to start looking for a tomato hornworm. But most of the time, tomato hornworms, in a small garden, you can go through and hand pick these off. If you had a very large production, I know some of you gardeners out there like to grow, 30 tomato plants in your backyard. I won't let make you raise your hand, but that may be a lot of tomato plants to manage. You may have to do or get an organic chemical. So some of the things that attack this are parasitic wasps, and then what happens is those wasps lay their eggs in the body of the hornworm, and then the larvae of those wasps eat around the vital organs of that tomato hornworm, allowing it to live as long as possible. And then all of a sudden, you'll start to see these white pupal sacs. Now, I'll show a picture later on. Most people think these are eggs. Now, it's when this tomato hornworm is parasitized with these white pupal sacs that I am able to find them on the plant. Of course, it's already been parasitized. That's beneficial insects. I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to allow those parasitic wasps to have their way. And then when it comes to learning more about tomato hornworm, we know that the tomato hornworm turns into a beautiful hummingbird moth, a hawk moth. These are more prevalent at the end of the season. These tomato hornworms are going to pupate in your soil. So you know that if you have a tomato hornworm infestation, disking your soil for the following year is extremely important in preventing those adults from coming out and laying eggs on your tomatoes. However, it can be very hard not to want the adults. Now, I know the tomato hornworm is not quite as beautiful as this one, this white lined sphinx moth. If you have petunias or you have perennials that bloom late in the season, you're gonna see this guy everywhere. This is actually the adult of a hornworm, and you see the hornworm in the top right corner. This was actually a hornworm eating sun drops. So even though this is, this is like an insect that we hate in the larval form, but we absolutely love in the adult form. And this is what a tomato hornworm looks like as an adult. Not quite as beautiful as that white lined sphinx moth, but definitely a magical sight. So you see these white pupal sacs. If you see this white pupal sacs on your tomato hornworm, you know you don't have to do anything because, like I said earlier, you have future beneficial insect control. If there's large portions of these and you don't see the white pupal sacs and the worm is aggressively munching, so that might indicate that you might have to do some sort of biopesticide. Now, the biopesticide that I would promote for this would be, BT or insecticidal soap or spinosad. So here's what BT looks like under a microscope. I know I'm such a nerd. I'm like, can we get a under the microscope picture of that chemical? What is a biopesticide? What does it mean? It really just means that it has a lower toxicity to the environment, to humans, and to wildlife. It's usually safer, but not always. It can be less effective, meaning if I spray this BT, I do one round of sprays the first time I spray, I might get 40 to 50% efficacy with using a biological chemical. If I wanted to use a harsher chemical, again, I wouldn't be organic anymore and I would be killing more insects, I could potentially get a 90, 95% rate of kill. So when you think about using a biopesticide and you spray it, never think that you are going to get 100% kill. That is never going to happen. When it comes to doing, doing organic pest control in a vegetable garden, you're kind of like teetering on a heavy population and a little population. I mean, to get complete eradication is never the 100% goal when it comes to attacking insects with organic pesticides. I know it's, people want to go out and they want to spray the carbaryls and the sevens, and that kills everything. You're not going to get that kind of kill with an organic pesticide, a biopesticide. So you look at this BT, it's actually composed of proteins from a bacteria. What the insect does is it eats it. And then this actually kind of destroys their guts. This chemical is very effective on caterpillars, like your cabbage loopers and your imported cabbage worms, but also your tomato hornworm. This BT has a very minimal impact on your natural enemies, though it will kill non-target caterpillars. Meaning, if you had this, let's say, near some milkweed, probably wanted to be very careful not to allow it to spray over. So tomato hornworm, in conclusion, you're going to look for those parasitic wasps by seeing those white pupas on the tomato hornworms. You're going to scout that garden for those stripped plants and the poop. You're going to hand pick them. And then you're going to potentially use a BT or a spinosad if you have a much larger population. Okay, now we're going to get to the, I don't know about you guys, but flea beetles are awful this year. And I say that every year because I really cannot stand flea beetles. There is something about them. I think it's because I always try to grow eggplant. Now, growing eggplant, seriously, I don't know why every vegetable gardener does not grow eggplant, because you grow a little tiny plant, you can get these humongous fruits off of it. I mean, it's like the poundage of fruits you get per plant is incredible. And eggplants, you don't have to have much room and you don't have to have put much into it to get that incredible harvest. But eggplant are notorious for being attacked by flea beetles. Now, flea beetles are the worst in the earlier spring, especially when your plants are little. You have a nice, big, healthy plant, it gets attacked by a flea beetle, maybe it can handle it. But it's a little tiny plant, it gets attacked by flea beetles. They leave these kind of shot holes in it. And it can be quite devastating. So this will get on radish, broccoli, spinach, potato, tomato, and pepper. However, from my personal experience, I can have tomato and pepper right next to the eggplant and they will decimate the eggplant. One of the things that I think is extremely important when it comes to flea beetles is the concept of exclusion with row covers. I mean, for you to be out there and to be able to spray these beetles on a daily basis, not quite as effective as if you were to cover them. Now, these row covers are in garden centers everywhere. And if you ever visit an organic vegetable gardener, you are going to see them utilizing these exclusion nettings a lot on almost all of their crops because they don't want to spray chemicals on it at all. And they don't want the damage. So I really encourage people to use row covers when it comes to protecting themselves from flea beetles. Obviously, you take the row covers off when the plant begins to flower. At that point, the plant is much healthier and can handle any damage or defoliation that those flea beetles cause. Another thing you can do is you can use radishes as trap crops. So usually when it's time to plant your eggplant, the radishes are have already been harvested or close to harvest, but and we've told you to stop planting at this point in time, otherwise they're going to develop in warmer temperatures and thus taste awful. But if you were to leave some little croppings of radish, the flea beetles prefer the radish over the eggplant. And so the concept is they'll go attack that radish, not attack your eggplant. And then you can either spray the radish or get rid of the radish or just allow it to be there. But this is not 100%. I mean, nothing that I say is 100%. You might have to use multiple techniques, meaning you might use exclusion in the beginning. You might allow some radish to grow. And once you take that exclusion off, you allow the radish to grow and you allow them to flower. And the radish flowers are actually edible. They're quite tasty. And they will attract beneficial insects to the rest of your garden also. Another thing that I wanted to show you was this is a treatment of exclusion right here. And so you look, you can tell which one was excluded and which one was left in the open. One of the things that we had, we covered it, and one of the things that we had inside were aphids. The aphids were on the plants, and you can see right there, there are two little ants trying to farm the aphids. But as soon as I open up that row cover, these were covered for about 4 weeks. As soon as I opened that row cover, beneficial insects came in and took care of all those aphids for me within less than a week. So I started out with a much healthier plant and I didn't spray anything and all I had to do was cover it. I know it's not as pretty as looking in the backyard and seeing these cute little rows of plants, but when it with you wanting to be organic, this is one of the things that I really think is beneficial when it comes to flea beetles. Another thing is you can use a pyrethrum that is, it is actually not OMRI, not organic, it is organic because it's basically made from a replication of a natural element from chrysanthemum. And it's much safer. I personally am all about using biological chemicals and I have no problem using permethrin. I like that it is safer. And then I like that I'm not killing everything. So that seems to one of the things that when it comes to aphids, you know, if you ever have a bad aphid infested, you know, I used to work in a greenhouse. Aphids were a problem in a greenhouse. Every now and then you'd get these volunteers coming in through our greenhouse vents, these little wasps or stuff, where aphids were a real problem if you allowed the populations to get too big. But out in nature, aphids really aren't that huge of an issue. The only time that aphids tend to cause concern for master gardeners is when they have those yellow oleander aphids on their milkweed. And so I have to tell you to not mess with them, because even if you were to go and try to spray off those aphids, you might potentially spray off a monarch egg. So, you know, I love finding aphids because I can find multiple beneficial insects, from green lacewings to ladybug larva to hoverfly larva. And it really is kind of like an Instagram photo shoot for me. But this right here, I mean, seriously, this plant on the left is so much healthier than the plant on the right. Again, I told you to use radishes as a trap crop. That seed can be, you know, I don't know about you, but I always have leftover radish seeds. Radish is so easy to grow, and it's like the easiest, fastest crop ever. So, I mean, seriously, even if you had some eggplants now, which, you know, we're getting to the latter stage of flea beetles, a radish might actually help. Colorado potato beetle. Now, this is one of the ones where biological chemicals actually stopped some beneficial insect research in its tracks. You know, it's hard to get sometimes the industry to implement beneficial insects in their pest management program. Again, because they have to, you know, have a certain level of pest for those beneficial insects to work. Well, what was happening was Colorado potato beetles were getting drastic pesticide resistance. So all these chemicals that had previously worked were no longer working, no longer killing. So the growers had to go to beneficial insects. Well, so they started doing stuff like, you know, putting down plastic mulch because they don't really like the plastic, or putting down flowers to encourage beneficial insects like your stink bugs and your assassin bugs, or they were doing crop rotation, or they were doing trap cropping with horseradish and tansy. But then a spinosad came out. And so that gave them a new chemical mode of action. And spinosad is wonderful. It's like one of the ones that I constantly say, oh, it'll work on this, it'll work on that. It's a good chemical for us, but know that it kind of stopped the industry a little bit. So spinosad, if you have Colorado potato beetle, spinosad. Another thing is, where are these adults overwintering? These adults are overwintering in crop debris. So if you're one of those, you know, how horticulturists were always telling you not to clean up your landscape. Well, when it comes to Colorado potato beetle, clean that baby up, because otherwise you're leaving behind some potential problems. Now, when you do your crop rotation, when it comes to insects, it can be, I love how we are like crop rotation in this day and age, when the majority of us don't have the garden the size of our grandparents, right? Do you remember going out in the back, whatever you call it, where there were rows and rows and rows of tomatoes? I remember it. I meant that's all what I had to do all summer is go take care of vegetables. And surprisingly, I hated it back then, but now I would pay you to go do it. But so crop rotation, I'm hesitant to say that, because most of you probably don't have the size of a garden that it takes to truly have crop rotation benefit when it comes to prevention of insects. So most of the time, what I tell you is to not grow this crop. You know, you have Colorado potato beetle this summer, and it is a horrible infestation, and you just struggled with it all summer long. Do not grow potatoes next year. Take some time off. You would not believe how 1 or 2 years off will actually benefit you. I reached out to a grower. When I first started this job, there was a late freeze. And the late freeze got all the apple trees. And so I felt bad for these orchardists. And I reached out to this orchardist in Champaign, and I said, what does this mean to you? And he was like, it's actually a welcome relief. I was like, what do you mean by that? And he was like, I get a year off of managing insects. So it's like that orchard had a year of reprieve from all those insect buildup. So, which I thought was, you know, a really quite brilliant way of looking at it. I'm sure he lost lots of money, but maybe he increased the overall health of his orchard by not having those apples on the trees that year. So, you know, we see beneficial insects. I love it how we see beneficial insects and they are attacking these. You would be surprised how many beneficial insects are out there. Something is eating eggs, something is eating larvae, something wants something. And they're just not, you know, they just don't come in and decimate the population usually. Usually they do it slowly. So when you're all seeing those insect pests, you're going to also want to look for some beneficial insects and think, do I have, you know, if I have like a million aphids and only 2 beneficial insects, then maybe. But, you know, it's nice to see some of these garden pests being devoured by beneficial insects. So would you necessarily, if you saw this spotted lady beetle out here eating those Colorado potato beetle eggs, would you necessarily want to spray? I don't know. I think it would be a good picture op. I mean, if you saw lots of them, then maybe you wouldn't want to spray. You would definitely want to scout every day and monitor the situation. This is Bavaria bustiana. This is another chemical, and what it is a chemical that naturally occurs in our soils. This caterpillar, which this is an army worm, could have potentially been infected with this just by being out in nature, being in soil. And when we think about when we're trying to raise things, like you think about raising monarch caterpillars and swallowtails, and some of them don't make it to adulthood because they are succumbing to things like this that happen in nature, diseases and parasites. Well, this is one where the spores of the fungi, they actually adhere to the insect. I love knowing how the chemical kills the insect, if you can't tell. And it dissolves that skin cuticle. It works really well on aphids, thrips, whitefly, mealybugs, potato beetle larvae, and caterpillars. So I really think this would be an awesome one when it comes to potato beetle larvae. And, you know, this is one that I used in the greenhouse. Now, you guys don't have to deal with thrips and whitefly and aphids and mealybugs the way we did in the greenhouse. So this was a really important chemical for us, a biological. And then even though this is an ingredient that is derived from the soil, I would not want to spray this on a actively flying bee because I would end up killing it. So definitely if you are going to use some of these, read the labels. They will tell you if they want you to avoid during when bees are active. And this is one that, even though it is naturally derived, it will kill the bees. Cucumber beetle, can't stand the cucumber beetles either. I mean, this is going to be a PowerPoint of me hating these bugs, the next one even more than I do the before one. But my gosh, these cucumber beetles are awful. What is so awful about them is that they transmit disease. And so any of you have come out and had you sat there, you planted the seed, you nurtured you watered it, you fertilized it, you start getting this beautiful cucumber plant, and then all of a sudden it just wilts down to nothing. And all that work, it's for now. And that is because of the cucumber beetles. And what they're doing is they're transmitting bacteria wilt. And the only way that you can really prevent this from happening is by exclusion. So again, I'm asking you to cover your cucumber and squash in the beginning, and you'll see why more later with the squash. Another thing is, you know, you cover them for the first, 30, 40 days of production. You uncover them because we know cucumbers and squash want to be pollinated. By that time, the cucumber beetles are still out, but they're on other flowering stuff, and they might not attack quite as much. Another potential strategy is to plant plants instead of seeds. Now, we as gardeners usually plant cucumber and squash by seeds. It's just much easier. In fact, transplants can be difficult to put in the ground. They can be, a little finicky. But it's the young plants where the cucumber beetles attack those young plants that just stunt them, and then they get the bacterial wilt, and then you're done. Planting transplants, a plant that actually has, 4 or 5 leaves versus planting a seed that's just going to have these tender, just delicious leaves come out. So row cover, usually the first 30, 40 days. Again, that depends on you. Those row covers allow in sunlight and moisture. They can be reused. They really are quite useful. Again, this one is sanitation. Sometimes if you have a lot of cucumber beetles, you can do a fall application because I think it's the striped that overwinter. Oh, I knew I was going to mess this up. The striped overwinter and the spotted go down south. I think it's the other way around. I think the spotted overwinter here and the striped go south. So if they're overwintering here, what they're doing is they're overwintering in weeds or crop debris. So if you had a huge population of cucumber beetles, you could do a Bavaria bassiana spray in the late fall to prevent some of them from overwintering in your area. Another thing is you can use winter squash as a trap crop. They actually are preferred the winter squash. And then you can use horticulture oils, soaps, spinosad. Here we are covering some greens. You look at how little plant damage is on that plant, the little effort that it took in putting this frost cloth down early in the season and just allowing it to be that way for 30 to 45 days before the plant gets bigger. Never had to spray a thing, didn't really even have to scout, right? I mean, you want to like peek in there to check on the watering and check on the growing, but really, you know, really beneficial to use this frost cloth. Oh, now we have squash. Oh, who doesn't? Yeah, here. Out of order. Okay, squash bug. Okay, we have the squash bug. Oh, is he not beautiful or what? Oh man, squash bugs are the bane. Seriously, this is the other one that I tell people all the time. They'll come in, they'll have squash bugs, and they'll be like, how do I take care of them? I'm like, there's no way. Once you have adult squash bugs, you're no longer organic. It is impossible to be organic. You're going to have to go into your arsenal of chemicals to kill those adults. So what you do is you prevent them by constantly scouting, looking for those eggs, looking for those nymphs. Those nymphs, when they're young, they stay together, they congregate. How easy would it be just to pinch that whole leaf off with those orange eggs on it? Or how easy would it be for me to spray a little insecticidal soap on these nymphs and kill them and easily penetrate their exoskeleton? I could not kill an adult squash bug with insecticidal soap. I guess you could drown them and it might work, but it's not going to work effectively if you have a huge infestation. So you grow squash right away. You say from the very standpoint, you're going to have squash bugs. They're so prolific, they're everywhere. What are you going to do? Or you could not grow squash, which is a very smart strategy. You could cover them, or you could start scouting and know when those eggs start being laid and get on top of those eggs and those young nymphs and control them. But, you know, again, controlling at the final end is almost impossible. Another thing is, you know, if you can take a year off, I say this all the time with gardeners, take a year off. And I actually think it makes a pretty big difference. I know that squash and cucumbers are rather easy to grow. And I'm sorry, but it could potentially help you out. Oh, I did not want to talk about Japanese beetles. Japanese beetles, they like my basil. Oh my gosh, it irritates me. One of the things about Japanese beetles is that they leave behind a feeding hormone. And what they're doing is they're saying to the rest of the Japanese beetles, hey, this plant tastes pretty good. And so you have a few, before you know it, the population skyrockets. So you have to remove those lacy foliages. You say, Kelly, I'm removing the whole plant. Yes, I realize that. Sometimes when I get Japanese beetles, damaged Japanese beetles coming to grab my basil, I will, I'll cut those basils back by half to try to get rid of that lacy foliage. Or I might even try to use exclusion on that basil while those Japanese beetles are out for that 4 to 5 weeks. Another thing that, when we think about Japanese beetles is, we're being encouraged to use some of these neonicotinoids that go up into the sap of the plant. And then it, as the Japanese beetles are eating that plant, they die. But what they're finding is that these neonicotinoids are transferring to the plant flower pollen and poisoning bees. So when you think about some of those systemic drenches that they tell you that work for Japanese beetles, if it's a summer flowering plant, you're potentially doing more harm than you are good. You might as well just let the Japanese beetles have it. So usually when I tell people about Japanese beetles, I say, don't grow things that Japanese beetles like, because, you know, it's going to be a constant battle. But the secret to Japanese beetle is getting it in the first 2 weeks. I meant attack that population in the first 2 weeks. Those next 4 weeks will be much easier. You allow it to multiply and you allow just a few to come in and it's going to be out of control. I mean, I've had people tell me that they have covered their grapes because of Japanese beetles. So they tend to come out at a time where it's, you know, harsh for vegetable gardeners. Again, there, you know, some of these chemicals will, these biological chemicals will work on Japanese beetles, but just that prevention of removing that lacy foliage in the first 2 weeks is, I think, is the personally the key to Japanese beetles. I may say that you may have Japanese beetles dripping off of your plants because, you know, they are so variable. I mean, I will have one part of my area that I serve that is just inundated with Japanese beetles, and we won't see them in another part of our area. And the very next year, it'll be completely different in how these Japanese beetle work. So they're kind of irritating me as far as I can't predict where they're going to be. I don't even think anybody else can. The entomologist can't either. I know that there was some talk about there's something going on with they're getting a potential disease, but clearly disease is not moving fast enough because they still are a huge issue for Illinois gardeners. And some people in, you know, really highly infected areas, I mean, they could just strip them. I know I'm preaching to the choir here, and I didn't really give you much to go on other than attack in the first 2 weeks, remove all that lacy foliage. I meant remove it, get rid of it. And, you know, potentially think about covering some of your more prized crops. Imported cabbage worm. Oh, this is the reason why I don't love growing broccoli, just because it's so hard to manage these cabbage worms. And again, you go back to that exclusion, you go back to the crop rotation, you go back to, you know, really managing this plant and constantly being out there and looking at it and making sure you don't have holes and, you know, turning over those leaves and smushing those caterpillars. And if you have lots of caterpillars, then you're going to use something like the BT or the spinosad or the neem oil. And then you're probably only going to get a small percentage of them. So you're probably going to have to come back a week or two later and do it again. So this is really sanitation. These things also are overwintering in the soil. So you're going to do some sanitation. And you know how these cabbage whites, oh, they're such pretty butterflies. And, you know, I've constantly thought that cabbage white really has a bad rap, because if we ate milkweed, monarchs would have a bad rap. But because we don't eat milkweed, monarchs are celebrated and put on a pedestal. But because cabbage whites eats our cabbage, we go out there with tennis rackets and start trying to kill the butterflies. Kind of sad. But if you would want holy cabbage, nobody wants this. Nobody wants kale that looks like this. Nobody wants broccoli that look like this. So this, again, exclusion, you know, looking, you know, I had a a friend who used to pay his kids to use their tennis rackets to go and get the butterflies. And those are those white butterflies with the little dots on the abdomens. Weed control really, really important in this. And again, the BT and the exclusion. Spider mites. This is one that I had in the greenhouse all the time. It was one of my nemesis, spider mites. What they do is they rasp the cells and they suck out the chlorophyll and they really diminish the health of the plant. Now, they are more prolific when it comes to dry weather. Now, if you've heard of the spruce spider mite, it is more prolific when it comes to cooler weather. But every now and then, you'll get spider mites on some of your vegetables or some of your landscape shrubs. And you turn them over, they'll be webbing, they'll be on the undersides of the leaves. And it's usually, they proliferate in hot, dry conditions. One of the things that you can potentially do is you can increase the humidity just by spraying the leaves. You can kill some of these guys. You can spray insecticidal soap on them. Again, as long as they are not a monocot, which means corn or grasses, because insecticidal soap will kill those. And you can knock down the population a little bit. But just so you know, when it comes to spider mites, any insecticide will not do. It needs to be something that will address spider mites, because technically they're not insects and these chemicals are not going to work the same on them. Insecticidal soap works because what it does is it covers the body and prevents that insect from breathing. So it kind of suffocates the insect. But just know that when I go and spray insecticidal soap on this plant, I'm not killing the eggs. I'm going to have to wait another 7 to 10 days, come back out and take care of these. So one of the things of increasing the humidity, could be a potential issue. Spraying off the plants, spraying off the webbing can be really great too. I used to release beneficial insects, but I know that these beneficial insects occur in nature. So I've gone up to spider mite populations and actually seeing the predator mites. And the predator mites are faster and they move a little bit more around the plant. And you'll notice that there'll be different, different colors of the mites too. So I don't feel like spider mites are as big of an issue in nature as they were for me in the greenhouse, but I do see some vegetables and shrubs getting this. If you are an experimental person and you don't have a spider mite dripping from the plant, which if you do, you could order some predator mites off of line. And you could release those predator mites on your plants. What I would do is if there were a huge population, is I would first knock them back with an insecticidal soap, and then I would actually apply the predator mites. Now, the predator mites can be found online. They come in this canister of bran, it's a carrier, and then you just sort of like sprinkle this around the plant. And then what it does is it introduces that predator mite. And usually there's two different types of predator mites, one that's very voracious and eats them up fast, and one that can eat other things and sticks on the plant for a while. So, if you were to, let's say you were to have a very large population of plants that get attacked by spider mites, buy some beneficial insects. These things work wonders in the greenhouse. Seriously, we use these on everything when it came to spider mites. But, you think about it, one of my first greenhouse experience was research greenhouse at the University of Illinois. And so I grew a lot of soybeans and spider mites. This was my biggest nemesis in the greenhouse. And so once we found these predator mites and we released them at the right time, you know, we knew that the predator mites were, we knew that we were going to have spider mites, right? So we would go ahead and order the predator mites depending on, knowing we were going to have spider mites, right? We knew. And so we'd order them and once we started seeing them, we'd release them right away. And I would even release them before I actually saw the spider mites. And I would go back and scout. It was amazing at how incredible it worked. Okay, so I just wanted to conclude with spotted wing Drosophila. A couple of years back, I made a video on spotted wing Drosophila. Would love to share it with you guys. And just to anybody who's growing raspberries or I found them in tomatoes. This is a potential future invasive species that we are battling. And this is potentially a way that you might have spotted wing Drosophila. So with this video, you can figure out why you should care and then how you protect your food.
Hi, my name is Kelly Allsup, and I am a horticulture educator for University of Illinois Extension. Today, I'm here at the Sustainable Student Farm on campus. And we are here to talk about a potential pest on fruits in your backyard, spotted wing Drosophila. I know it sounds like a big name, but it is a fruit fly, an invasive species for here in Illinois. What's different about the spotted wing Drosophila and other fruit flies is that it has a serrated ovipositor, which means it can lay its eggs in unripe fruit. And by the time you go to harvest them, you already have fully formed larvae. Other fruit flies have to wait until the fruit is ripe in order to lay eggs in it. So most of the time, you've already harvested before that fruit fly comes in. One of the ways that you can detect spotted wing Drosophila in your raspberries or your blackberries or whatever soft skinned fruit you have is you can smash the fruits in your hand and you will find little white larvae that have already started growing to quite a large size within your ripened fruit. A second method to determine if you have spotted wing Drosophila larvae within your fruits is to take a small sample of the fruit, submerge it in a bowl with salt water, and they will actually come to the surface of the water and you'll be able to detect it then. Another way to detect spotted wing Drosophila before you actually have them laying eggs in the unripe fruit is construct your own trap like this one. What I've done is I've taken a little paint can and I've put holes in it. I've actually put red tape on it because the spotted wing Drosophila are attracted to that color. On the inside, we have a yellow sticky trap, which when I peel, they'll stick to it. And I will also put apple cider vinegar in the bottom as a way to attract them to the plant. So I'm just going to place the trap in amongst the plant so that I will detect the adult of spotted wing Drosophila. Once the adult spotted wing Drosophila are seen in the trap, it is time to take action. One thing that organic fruit growers do is they use an exclusion netting over the plants so the spotted wing Drosophila do not have access to the unripe fruits.